For me, I'm very passionate about art, but I don't see myself doing anything else but art. I like breathe art. It's almost like that. Like in television, I used to get like a box full or few boxes full of letters after like three months, and they were all handwritten. But I think it's important, like at every sort of moment in my life, I've realized that, you know, these kind of challenges sort of come your way, and it's on you, like whether you want to do it or not.
Click the bell icon to never miss any update.
So tell us how your journey with MAD began. Like, were you already an established artist by then, or how did, you know, how did MAD come to you?
No, I wasn't an established artist, but I was doing fairly well. So I was doing animation work. I had studied animation filmmaking from NID, and I moved to Bombay. I was working with a studio, and we used to do a lot of animation work for television channels, for brands, making music videos and ads and things like that. So I was doing fairly well. Everyone has a unique style. So you wait for that moment where you sort of realize that you have invented your own style and people recognize you with that. I had reached that sort of phase where people could look at the work and say, that's my work. And you know, that's like a great milestone for any animator. And that was the time when I designed an animation package for another kids channel. And that's when Pogo called me and they asked me to visit their office. But when I met them, I realized that they had an idea, a concept in mind where they wanted to make a kids television show, an art show. They were looking for people to not only develop the content for them, but to host it also, which I had no experience with. So I flat out sort of refused, and I said, I don't think I can do it because that's not my cup of tea. But I think it's important, like at every sort of moment in my life, I've realized that, you know, these kind of challenges sort of come your way, and it's on you, like whether you want to do it or not. And I thought maybe I should take this up as a challenge and do it. So I said yes to them. Only on a condition where I said, because I am not a trained actor or I have no experience with television or camera, you let me develop the show my way. Let me come up with all the ideas.
The show started off at a time when there was not much access to internet. You know, internet was not very popular back then. And how did you come up with these DIY ideas back then? Like when there was nothing, like you couldn't look up to anything. So all you had to do was come up with it by yourself. So how was that experience?
Yeah, there was no internet. I mean, internet wasn't big, like you said. And there was no DIY also, like, you know, by that time, this whole term DIY wasn't coined. You know, everyone said, oh, hobbies, art and craft, this, that, other. But I was doing it back then also. A lot of people think that I often copy ideas from the internet, or that's what my source of inspiration is, but that's not true.
Right. So let's slip a little bit into your early life. So as a child, Rob, what drew you into art? Like what drew you into these DIY videos, and what? How did it all start?
Like any other kid, I used to enjoy drawing a lot. I used to love colors. I used to love painting. But I think what sort of solidified my interest, or, you know, like the fact that I love art, is when I started reading a lot of comic books and watching a lot of animated content. That's when I realized that I really love this, because I wanted to replicate that. So I used to read a lot of comic books, and every time I would read a comic book, I would just sit and start drawing my own characters, you know, building my own stories. But I feel that I'm like a storyteller, and I love you know, building my own stories. So even as a kid, I think art gave me that sort of tools to bring my characters to life and build my own sort of imaginary world. I come from like a middle class family, and even though I had a really amazing childhood, we traveled a lot and we had everything we needed, but my parents were very strict about buying certain toys. Certain toys were very expensive, so we were not allowed to, you know, get those toys. So as a kid, I was like, if I can't buy this, then how can I make this myself? So I would sit and work with different materials, cardboard boxes, wood, this, that, other, and try and make my own things, you know. And I think that habit continued and helped me a lot when I started, you know, working for television and building my own things.
In your early days, you created characters that you imagine. So what does art mean to you?
What does art mean to me? Like I said, I enjoy making stuff. I enjoy creating stuff. People often say that art is like therapy. You know, for me, I'm very passionate about art, but I don't see myself doing anything else but art. You know, I like breathe art. It's almost like that.
So moving on, you have worked for TV and now you have two YouTube channels. So is there any shift that you have seen from TV to social media? So how is that shift, and has there any, have you kind of changed the way you present your videos, or is it been the same?
Oh, absolutely. They are completely different mediums, you know. Do you watch TV anymore?
Not really.
There you go, you know. Yeah. So for me, the switch happened because I realized that there's no more appointment viewing. But now, that screen size is very small. So when you're developing content, you have to keep in mind that somebody is holding it up close. You know, so that becomes a very sort of personal, intimate sort of experience for a viewer. Right. So then we had to design content that when you're viewing it on a small screen, sort of fits to that format.
Yeah.
So my television show was like a 4-camera, 5-camera setup, and now I just shoot with like 1 camera.
Yeah, I mean, even when it was television, it was like more like a one-way communication. But now now it's like you can actually your fans or anybody, you know, they can communicate with you.
Yes, and the interactivity has increased so much. Like right. Doing television, I used to get like a box full or few boxes full of letters after like 3 months, and they were all handwritten. But now, no sooner I put up a video or a post, instantly, you know, there are comments and you know, like DMs and things like that. So yeah, you can interact and engage with your audience.
Rob, you're also a motivation speaker right now. So share us some experience about that.
It wasn't like a conscious decision to move into this space and become a motivation speaker. I realized that a lot of people who sort of followed me as a kid are now adults, you know, or young adults, youth. And, you know, a lot of them are also in creative professions. So they often come to me for advice, for inspiration, for motivation. So I thought it's only fair that, you know, as I help them in their journey, that at now at this phase also, I should do something that will give them sort of the right direction. I think, you know, mental health issues or mental health, it's real, you know, people are suffering, you know, and we need to address it. It's very important. Sometimes all they need is, you know, just a few words, somebody to talk to, somebody to say the right things. You know, I have this weapon, I have this tool to put out positive messages all the time. And I feel that my art anyways is very positive. Every time I try and create something that brings happiness to people. So I thought this would be a great way, you know, to convey messages. So I started making reels, I started making short videos, posts and things like that revolved around mental health issues.